Good morning again.
Good morning.
Throughout all cultures dating back to antiquity, we find stories of dragons and dragon slayers. And today we're going to talk about in the steps of the dragon slayer, or as the Greek, drakon, the drakon slayer. But in a very real sense, these myths have a basis of reality. You know, seven times in the book of Revelation, Satan is called the drakon. And he is finally destroyed by God. He is the foe that we face. Notice in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, if you would please, chapter 2, verses 7 through 9. Paul there says, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders." The Bible speaks about a mystery of iniquity that Satan is going to work through in these last days. In fact, Paul says even in his day, that spirit of iniquity, that spirit of man controlling men, because that ultimately is what the spirit of iniquity is. It's men controlling men, had already begun to work in the day of Paul. But he says this is going to culminate in the very end of time. And he's going to work with signs and powers and lying wonders because he's working after the manner of Satan. Now, I've mentioned to some of you that I've been reading through volumes, volume 2 of the Testimonies, and trying to read through the Testimonies this year or into next year, whatever it takes me, Testimonies for the Church, Bell and White. And I'm just finding all these good statements. Some of them I've read before, and some of them I've probably neglected. But here's one that I read this last week that impressed me. And it was like a wake-up call, made me shake and think a little bit. It says, "Satan has great advantages. He possessed the wonderful intellectual power of an angel, of which few form any just idea. Satan was conscious of his power, or he would not have engaged in a conflict with the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." And that's from volume 2 of the Testimonies, page 171. So think about that. Satan didn't go into his warfare against Christ unmindful that he was indeed very powerful, very intelligent, much more sly and slick and understanding than any of us. But I'd like to say today that Satan can and must be resisted. Because first of all, Satan's power, though he is powerful, the Bible tells us his power is limited. Let's just go back to the book of Job as an example. Now, Job comes just before the book of Psalms, just a little more than halfway, before the halfway point of your Bible. In Job chapter 1, and we'll just read a little bit of this story here in verse 6 through 12. "Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, Doth Job fear God for naught? Now notice verse 10. Hast not thou made an hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land." What he's saying is, you've kept me from doing with Job what I've wanted to do with Job. You've put this hedge about him. But not only him, you've put it about his substance and all that he has. And we learn later that included his children. He says, "But put forth thine hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in thy power. only upon himself, put not forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. And we know he started to do a lot of havoc, didn't he? But the point is this, that God is able to put a hedge about his people, and Satan can go no further, can do no more than what God allows him to do. Okay? In Job chapter 2 and verse 6, the Lord again said unto Satan, behold, he's in thine hand, but save his life. And now Satan is going to be allowed to touch Job personally, physically, but he can't kill him. You see, there's limits, only what God allows. Now I'd like to say this. The case of Job is not unique. Did you get that? His case is not unique. In fact, I would like to say that his case is our case, and it is ubiquitous in that it is the case of every one of us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13, I like this text. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. Here Paul says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. And so God is telling us, each one of us, he's telling you, Sister Arlene, he's telling you, Brother Jeff, he's telling you, Brother Don, he's telling each one of us that God has a hedge about each one of us. Now that hedge may be higher, may be shorter for, you know, each one of us, depending on the circumstances and what God in his wisdom decides to allow. But whatever he lowers or removes of that hedge, it has its limitations. And there's never a case where God lowers that hedge so much that we cannot still but be victors through the grace and the power of Jesus Christ. Satan, in fact, in Revelation 20, if we would turn there, Revelation 20, verses 1 through 3. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold on who?
The dragon.
The dragon. That old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years were finished. God has a way to bind Satan, and he can bind him just as much today as then, depending on what his need and his purpose calls for. We know that if we go on into the rest of this chapter, that finally fire will come down from heaven and destroy Satan, destroy the dragon. God is going to deal with him in the end. Now, if we look at the life of Jesus, and we're talking about following in his steps today, right?
Amen.
One thing that we need to keep in mind is that Jesus resisted the devil. In Matthew chapter 4, and we'll read verses 1 through 4, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Who's the devil? He's the dragon, isn't he? Okay. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. And he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And then the devil proceeded to do at least two other great temptations. And Jesus each time resisted. And he resisted the working and the power of the dragon. There's a text that I've shared with you before, and I'd like to share it again. It's in John chapter 1 and verse 5. But the uniqueness of this text for us today is that we need to understand or comprehend, as it were, one of these words a little better than what might appear on the surface. John chapter 1 and verse 5. I'll read verse 4 also. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. Now, who is this one who had life and the light of men in him? Who is the him here?
Jesus.
It's Jesus, right. Now, notice verse 5. And the light, this is the light of Jesus. He is the light. John 8:12. I am the light of the world, right?
Amen.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. But that word, that Greek word comprehended, it comes from a word katalambano. Katalambano. And it means to lay hold of or to make siege to overcome. In other words, the light shined in darkness, but the darkness did not overcome it. Do you see it? The darkness did not overcome it. In John 12, 35, then Jesus said unto them, yet a little while is the light with you. Walk while ye have the light, lest darkness come upon you. For he that walketh in darkness knoweth not whither he goeth. And it's the same thing. Knoweth not. He doesn't know. Come upon him. He doesn't know where he's going, but it says, yet a little while. Let me read that again. Yet a little while is the light with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness come upon you. When that expression come upon you is from the same Greek word. And in other words, you keep a point on the light, because if you don't, the darkness will come upon you. It will overtake you. It will overcome you. You see. Hebrews 4:15. He says, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. You see, Christ resisted Satan. He was tempted. Paul says in Hebrews that he resisted with strong crying and tears even. But I like this text in Hebrews 2:18. This last portion of Hebrews 2 is talking about the humanity of Christ and how important it was for him to take humanity and to live in flesh like we live in, and to be tempted like we're tempted. And then he says, for in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. And this word that we translate succor from the Greek, it comes from two words. One means to cry or to cry out, and the other means to run to the aid to. And it puts these two concepts together. And I like that because, you know, when I need help, I can't always go to where the help is. I might be working under a car, for instance, and maybe the jack gives way and now I'm pinned under the car and I'm crying out for help. I can't go get someone to come help me. I'm in trouble. But Jesus, he has help that comes to us. He cries out, I'm coming, and he comes to us. Isn't that beautiful?
Amen.
That really is beautiful. I appreciate that so much. In fact, another translation of this text says, for since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. He's able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. No long distance help here, but he's right by us. And I think this is what Paul had in mind when he was speaking there at Mars Hill in Acts 17. It's recorded. Acts 17, verses 26 and 27. There he says, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointing the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. You know, he's Paul speaking. He says about, you know, you've got these different people from all over the world. We all have one blood, of course. But he says you have these different people in different places. And he says, and yet the Lord is so near to each one of us that it's just like we could reach out and feel and touch him because he's right there. Aren't you glad for a Savior like that?
Amen.
Isn't that a blessing for us? Now, as Christians, we can resist Satan because Jesus resisted Satan. It's important for us to understand that Christ resisted Satan. And because he did, he can give us help in our time of need. I want you to notice a two-step program here in James chapter 4 and verse 7. James 4, 7. Right after the book of Hebrews, you have James near the back of the New Testament. James 4, 7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And who is the devil? He's the dragon, isn't he?
Yeah.
And we have a great dragon slayer who has went before us. But before we can resist the devil, we have to do something else. What do we have to do first? According to the text. Look at the text. What's the first thing the text says? Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. In other words, if we don't put ourselves in the hands and under the power of God, we can't resist the devil. There's no use trying. He is far more powerful than we are. He is far more intellectual than we'll ever be. But if we submit our hands into the one who holds everything, then with his power, we can resist the devil. I like this text in Luke 10:19. Luke 10:19. Jesus says to his disciples, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Now notice in this verse, if you look at the text, there are two usages of the English word power. Do you see those? And you may know that there are two main Greek words that are translated power in the New Testament. And one means power in the sense of authority, and the other means power in the sense of might or ability, exousia dunamis. And there's two different words used here. Which one do you think is the first usage? What is Christ going to give us? He gives us the authority. He gives us the authority to tread over the serpents and all the dunamis, the explosive mighty power of the Satan. See? And he gives us the authority to command his power, to use his power. It's not our power, it's his power, but he gives us the authority to run over the power of the devil. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. And we're going to see if you remember a lesson we gave you Wednesday night. And if you didn't tune in or weren't here Wednesday night, then I'm sorry you missed. We had a good lesson. He says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour." Seeking, he's seeking us. Was he seeking after Job? He was. I mean, it's true that God brought Job up to God. But Job says, "Oh yeah, I know about him. The reason I can't touch him is because you've put a hedge about him. And I know that because I've been trying, but I can't get in." Verse 9. He says, "Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world." He says, "Whom resist?" And this is just a little tricky in the translation, but what he's saying is, you resist him. You resist him. And if you want to look at the anatomy of this particular verb, it is what is called aorist. It is active. It is imperative, second person plural. And I told you what imperative meant this last Wednesday night. And maybe if you know English well enough, you'll know what the imperative is anyhow. But what does imperative mean? It is a command. It's a command. God doesn't tell us just to lay back and let things flow. He says you are to resist the devil. When the temptation comes to do something wrong, you're to resist it. You know, someone drops something on your foot and it hurts. And you want to scream and yell back at that person who innocently didn't mean to, and they're sitting there already worried and sorry, and you're tempted to want to yell back or scream or do something. He says you resist that. You say, "No, I will be calm by God's grace." You see, that's right, it's an imperative. Now in 1 John chapter 2 we find something a little different. 1 John chapter 2 verses 13 and 14. We talked about the imperatives, but we also talked about the indicative Wednesday night. Do you remember the indicative? And what was that? It's a declaration. It's a statement of fact. It's a statement of fact. Here we go. 1 John chapter 2, verse 13. "I write unto you, fathers, because you've known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one. And both those phrases in 13, 14, you've overcome the wicked one, they're identical. And these are in what we call the indicative mode. And you've overcome the wicked one. And it's interesting here in the Greek, when it says you've overcome the wicked one, the word one, O-N-E, it's not there. But it needs to be there. It needs to be there to be translated right. And it has to do, because the wicked is an adjective and it's a certain form, and it needs something there, and so the translators have put one in, even though it's not italicized, it is a supplied word, but it's the word necessary. Okay? But we're going to show you a couple places in a little bit where this has not been done, but should have been done. And it will, I think, open up the text a little bit for you. I hope it will. Now, we are to fight and to resist Satan because Jesus resisted. And just as God put a hedge about Job, he is able to put a hedge about his people. But I told you I was reading in volume 2 of the testimonies. And I read something else this week. It came just a page after what I read to you earlier, but it's on a little different line. But it says this: sometimes previous to a death or an accident, he, speaking about Satan, the dragon, he gives a dream, or personating another, converses with the medium, even imparting knowledge by means of his suggestions. And I'll just stop there for a minute. Did you realize that without the protecting power of God, Satan can give you suggestions why we're sitting here? Of course, we know that. But even when you sleep at night, he can put dreams in your mind. And this is why you need to pray and ask God's protection and watch care over you before you ever go to sleep.
Amen.
Amen.
Right? I remember when our children were younger, every night we prayed, Lord, please watch over their minds and put a hedge about them when they can't be mindful of things. And all the time our children were growing up, there was not a single nightmare in our home. Isn't that a blessing? Mm-hmm. Now it's true, we didn't have all these violent, gory movies, you know, that they were feasting upon during the day before they went to sleep. They didn't ever have those things. But we asked God to watch over them during the night, and God was faithful. God was faithful, and I'm just so thankful. Well, let me reading on. It is wisdom from beneath and not from above. What Satan gives is wisdom from beneath and not from above. The wisdom taught by Satan is opposed to the truth unless, to serve his purpose, he apparently clothes himself with the light which enshrouds angels. To a certain class of minds, he will come sanctioning a part of what Christ's followers believe to be truth, while he warns them to reject the other part as dangerous and a fatal error. He is just so sly in the way he works. But God is able to help us. He's able to give us wisdom. He's able to give us the power to overcome. In 1 John 4:4, it says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.
Amen.
See, that is if Christ is really in us. Now let's turn to 2 Thessalonians 3:3, and we're going to look at this concept of poneros. Poneros. 2 Thessalonians 3:3. He says, but the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. Do you want to be kept from evil? Well, and maybe in a certain sense, we certainly do. But we live in an evil world. Right? But this is a particular situation. The word evil here is in an adjective form, and it has the definite article ton before it, indicating it that it is to be taken, and I'm a little hard to pronounce this, but I'll try, subsubstantially, or close to that. In other words, it really should be translated just like we saw earlier, the evil one. The evil one. He says that God will keep you not just simply from evil and generic, but from the evil one. Who is the evil one?
The dragon.
He is the dragon. And I have a statement here. And this is Daniel B. Wallace's quotation in Biblical, A Basis of Biblical Greek, page 63. And speaking about this difference, and there is no little theological difference between the two. The father does not always keep his children out of danger, disasters, or the ugliness of the world. In short, he does not always deliver us from, and I'm going to add, the effects of evil. Because that's what he's really talking about, the effects of evil. We are exposed to a lot of things. He says, but he does deliver us from the evil one. The text is not teaching that God will make our life a rose garden, but that he will protect us from the evil one, the devil himself. The very arch enemy of all. And this is the same thing that happens in John 17:15. John 17:15. Jesus says, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. But it really should be translated the evil one. And this isn't an issue of Textus Receptus versus another text. They all have the same Greek text on this. And in Matthew 6:13, there's also a text in Luke, but I won't take time to go there now, but I do want to go to Matthew 6:13. This is what we call the Lord's Prayer. And just before the benediction of it, or there or whatever, he says, here we go, 6:13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. But in the Greek, it's this same expression, ton poneros. From the evil one. Deliver us from the evil one. In other words, keep the evil one away from us. Save us from the evil one. And really all the evil, all the wickedness that he does. That's what he's telling us to do. In Signs of the Times, March 29, 1905, Ellen White uses this term, deliver us from evil. The offering of this prayer by one who realizes his weakness makes the temptation of the enemy what?
Powerless.
If we ask, we can receive. You know, we are told that many times we don't receive because we don't what?
Ask.
We don't ask. And this is something we need to ask about because we need it in our lives. Jesus Christ, he had every day, every moment of his life, he had victory over Satan, didn't he? Victory over sin, victory over selfishness, victory over everything the dragon tried to do to him. And his victory on the cross, friends, is our great victory today.
Yes.
In Colossians 2, I'm going to read verse 14 because it helps with the context going into 15. Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. Here Paul says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against you, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. His cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Christ triumphed over all evil, and his victory is to become our victory as well. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14, now thanks be to God, which always causes us to do something. What? What does the text say? Always causes us to
triumph.
Now, when you triumph, that means you gain the victory, right?
Yes.
Always causes us to gain the victory in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. So we can triumph, but it's always and only in Christ. But just as Christ openly triumphed over the forces of evil, we too can always triumph over the forces of evil. In Revelation 12 and verse 11, my Bible just happened to open there, but I'll give you time. Revelation 12:11, speaking here of a group of people who are going to be redeemed. It says, and they overcame him. Now, who was the him you think they overcame? Verse 9. And the great dragon, the Draken, was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan and so on. And it says in verse 11, they overcame him, the dragon, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. So they overcame through the power and the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And we can too. I heard a couple different of the prayer requests, and I noticed them, that they were a little different than we had today. And these prayer requests each brought out the name of Jesus in their request. Because, you know, there is power in the name of Jesus. In Philippians chapter 2 and verse 10, Philippians 2 verse 10, Paul says that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Jesus said in Mark chapter 16 that they will cast out devils. How? In my name. In my name. And the disciples, after they had been sent out, the early disciples on the first missionary tour Christ sent them out on, they came back, as recorded in Luke chapter 10, verse 17. And they said unto Jesus, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Now we have to be careful. Just like in the book of Acts, it speaks about a certain group of Jewish vagabonds, it called them, that tried to imitate the example of Paul in casting out a demon by just simply using the name Jesus. And the demon said, well, look, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? Remember in James chapter 4, resist the devil and he'll flee from you, right? But what was that predicated upon us first doing? Submitting yourselves there unto God, and then resist the devil. And so we have to have this arrangement. It has to be in this order. Just calling out the name of Jesus means nothing unless we are abiding in Jesus. But I want to tell you, friends, God has a plan and He is sovereign. And although we may at times run counter to His sovereign plan, His sovereign plan in the overall picture is going to succeed, and His love is not going to be denied. And if we want Jesus, nothing, not even the devil, the dragon himself, can stop us. In Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39, Paul says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not even an angel, not even the dragon. Nothing can separate us if we will put our lives into His hands. If we will resist, if we will claim the victory of Christ, He will give us the authority to take the power of Satan away. In Select the Messages, Book 1, on page 124, it says, there is nothing that Satan fears so much as that the people of God shall clear the way by removing every hindrance so that the Lord can pour out His Spirit upon a languishing church and an impenitent congregation. If Satan had his way, there would never be another awakening, great or small, to the end of time. But we are not ignorant of his devices. Let me just pause. Why is it that we don't need to be ignorant of his devices? Because we have the Word of God.
Amen.
But friends, if this Word of God stays closed, maybe it's a nice ornament for the coffee table. You know, maybe every so often you take the dust off of it. We have the Word of God, friends. We are not, and we need not be ignorant of His devices. She goes on to say, it is possible to resist His power. When the way is prepared for the Spirit of God, the blessing will come. It will come. Satan can no more hinder a shower of blessing from descending upon God's people than he can close the windows of heaven that rain cannot come upon the earth. Wicked men and devils cannot hinder the work of God or shut out His presence from the assemblies of His people. What a blessing. If they will, with subdued, contrite hearts, confess and put away their sins and in faith claim His promises. So you see, there's the promise, but here's a condition now. put away sin, claim His promises. Come with a subdued, contrite heart. Every temptation, every opposing influence, whether open or secret, may be successfully resisted, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts, Zechariah 4:6. And it's found in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 124. And you know what, friends? When we resist the devil, it brings to us not only the victory over Satan, but it brings a blessing with it. God blesses His people when they serve Him and they fight. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, Paul, recounting his experience, he says, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love His appearing. He says, I have fought a good fight. And that word, fought, is in the Greek, means to battle as in a contest. This is March. And if you've never heard the expression March Madness, you probably have never heard anything in the news in the last month. You know, this big basketball tournament that the colleges hold every year, they call it March Madness. And I tell you, you know, whether it's the players from West Virginia was in, I don't know if they're still in or not, but they were in. West Virginia or Duke or North Carolina or California or wherever. I mean, they play hard. Those guys, they play hard. They're fighting as if in a battle, because to them it is a battle. But Paul says, I fought a good fight. I have been in a battle. And he says, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. If you read Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 3, there are seven churches there. And every one of those churches, Jesus gives a message at the end of His talk to them. And He says, to him that overcometh will I. And then He pronounces some kind of blessing. Or they will not be heard the second death. Or, you know, they will come and sit with me in my throne. He always offers them something, but it's always on the condition of their obedience. And their obedience can't happen, friends, without their resisting the devil.
Amen.
That's right. I'll give you the references if you want them. Revelation 2, 7, 11, 17, 26, and Revelation 3, 5, 12, and 21. Those are the references. Jesus Christ, He resisted and overcame Satan in His ministry. And He is. Christ is the dragon slayer. And we as His believers are commanded to follow His example in this respect, or to walk in His footsteps. We too are to be dragon slayers, but only in His strength and power as we go forth, beloved. God will assist you in your struggle. Are you ready to fight and to strive? You know, as Christians, we think of ourselves to a degree as pacifists. And when there was conscription, our believers would sign up as conscientious objectors, right? Or non-combatants, because we don't believe in fighting. But friends, we do believe in fighting, just not humans. We believe in fighting and warring against the Draken and all his forces. And we're willing to use every weapon that heaven disposes upon us. God has promised us power over not just simply evil, but He's promised us power over and over again against the evil one, against Satan himself. We who are the weakest of the weak of this earth can overcome He who was the mightiest of angels. Not that we have the power inherently, but we have the authority, we have the power, we have the exousia of God. With the power of God working with us, that we can overcome even the dragon. So, my question for you today is, will you volunteer to be a part of the Lord's army today and allow Him to be your commander as you follow in His footsteps to have victory over the dragon?
Amen.